The FDA approved Elon Musk's Neuralink to begin brain implants on people on the 25th of May this year. So what is Neuralink?
We put a chip in your brain to control your mind. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Concerns not alleviated.
Yeah, there you go. jump right in. Yeah. Step right up. Who wants one?
Elon Musk is driven by the mission to expand the scope and scale of human consciousness, and this video coincides with his launch of XAI, which aims to understand the true nature of the universe. So the question must be asked, can Neuralink rewire how we perceive reality and expand human consciousness? What we are essentially considering is the Oppenheimer moment of human consciousness, an evolutionary arms race from which there is no coming back. In this video, I will deconstruct the good, the bad, and the ugly with permission from Zuby with his recent interview with Elon Musk. And you can watch the full interview with Elon Musk on Zuby's YouTube channel, which I will link in the descriptions below. At an entry level, Neuralink promises neural rehabilitation for sensory and motor disabilities, for example, with tetraplegics and quadriplegics, where there is limited connection between the brain and body. Globally, 1 billion people suffer from some form of neurological condition. And in Australia alone, the payout for neurological conditions can be up to $70,000 per person, and this number continues to rise annually. The medical device marketplace has been cashing in on these business opportunities, with Nature Publishing marking 2023 as the year of brain-computer interfaces, or BCIs. We can look at BCIs at the level of the central nervous system. For example, the centrode, which does not penetrate the blood-brain barrier, but stimulates the brain from within blood vessels. Brain-computer interfaces can also stimulate the peripheral nervous system, which can be autonomic, for example, with vagus nerve stimulators, or it can be somatic, for example, in neuroprosthetics, which extract motor commands from the motor cortex, the spinal cord, and neuromuscular feedback. These technologies have existed since the 1970s when DARPA initiated BCI research to detect hidden information in the brain, which cannot be revealed through conventional communication channels. The extraordinary team at Neuralink advances this technology by light years by overcoming the surgical limitations using a fully automated and therefore scalable neurosurgery. Their Neuralink device implants 1,024 electrodes distributed over 64 threads directly onto the surface of the brain. The neurosurgical robot inserts these threads with a micrometer spatial precision, given that a single electrode is the width of only a couple of red blood cells. And this entire procedure is completed in under 15 minutes. As someone who has successfully completed over 30 neurosurgical procedures, I'm in awe of the technical sorcery that has gone into this surgery. And we cannot deny that the scalability of surgery can potentially change the lives of 1 billion people affected by neurological conditions. And this scores very favorably on the stakes for humanity. Yet, like the Oppenheimer moment, just because we can do something, does it mean we should? Elon disarms the audience with a generic textbook understanding that the cortex is simply trying to make the limbic system happy. I actually love how Elon jokes around and takes seemingly complex concepts and makes it easily accessible. As entertaining as this joking around deflects attention from the oversimplification of these concepts and leaves people with a false sense of security. The brain does not lend itself easily to the organizing principles of the universe, and there are some mysteries about the human brain that cannot be reduced to first principles. To equate the limbic system to primitive and basic instincts is the first critical flaw in Elon's thinking. He then reevaluates.
But your cortex is way smarter than your limbic system. But the irony is that even though the cortex is way smarter than the limbic system, most of what it's doing is trying to make the limbic system happy. It's like limbic system's hungry. Okay, let's get some food. Mm-hmm. Limbic system is horny. Okay, let's, you know, have sex or whatever.
The limbic system typically refers to the subcortical structures of the brain that are responsible for our survival response. For example, feeding, reproduction, and fight or flight. This is all well and great, but the subcortical structures are also the source of self-mastery, like the extraordinary ability of breath to modulate our autonomic function. At this point, I would question the sensibility of the Neuralink team. Sure, you can implant the brain with digital superintelligence, but this translates poorly to mastery of the mind. Neuralink can communicate high bandwidth information to our cortical surface, yet information by itself can be toxic, especially to the untrained mind. The true source of our intelligence is hidden below thought in the deep brain structures that hold the capacity to our true potential. How do I know? Because I can guarantee that Neuralink won't make you happy. Only you can do that. And if you want to learn more about what I mean, I talk in depth about how to train the mind in the brain-body connection video linked in the descriptions below. We are heading headfirst towards brain-machine interfaces, but we are yet to develop a healthy relationship with the brain-body interface. For the first time in recorded history, we are looking at a separation between intelligence and consciousness, and the brain is a primordial filter of consciousness. It does not generate consciousness itself. People often mistake altered states of perception with consciousness. Human consciousness is not perception, but the awareness that precedes it. The very nature of first principles therefore excludes consciousness by design. By dismissing the subcortical structures as primitive and taking a computational approach to human consciousness, Elon puts humanity in danger of losing connection with their own body, and therefore a biological relationship with reality. I personally don't see the point of extending our senses to a hyper-reality when we fail to inhabit our own body and grasp the true beauty inherent in this moment.
These smart arms are controlled by my brain through a neural link. Nanowires feed directly into my cerebellum, allowing me to use these arms to control fusion reaction in an environment no human hand could enter.
Doctor, if the artificial intelligence in the arms is as advanced as you suggest, couldn't that make you vulnerable to them?
How right you are. Which is why I developed this inhibitor chip to protect my higher brain function. It means I maintain control of these arms instead of them controlling me.
Did Elon just watch Dr. Octavius from Spider-Man 2 and decide it was a great idea?
We're already kind of a cyborg if you think of like your phone and your computers as an extension of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, like if you leave your phone behind, it's like you have missing limb syndrome. You're like, you know.
Elon already considers us to be cyborgs since our phones are an extension of ourselves. And he's not wrong. Some people already feel separation anxiety when they cannot locate their phone. Neuralink will eliminate this separation anxiety by literally adding another layer to the cortex so that we can embed artificial general intelligence onto the cortex and acquire symbiosis between the digital and biological mind. Astonishingly, we've already had a taste of what this looks like. Our first contact with AI has been with recommendation algorithms, which curate our content. And we've already seen the social engineering that has happened that has made us slaves to our own devices. And we've also seen the evolution of recommendation algorithms with each social platform. And you can learn more about how mindless scrolling is affecting the human brain in the TikTok video in the description below. Our second contact with AI has been with generative large language models such as ChatGPT. And these generative AI not only curate content, but they also create new content. And a critical flaw in people's imagination is that these generative models are somehow intelligent, to the point where they may even form emotional dependencies with AI. Sadly, I don't blame them. Because if we did have healthy, strong, stable emotional bonds, we would not be this desperate. We'd be horrified by these artificial bonds. The third contact with AI will be with Neuralink, a symbiotic digital hive mind where the voices inside your head will be indistinguishable from your own. On the one hand, Elon talks about AI moving too fast and then overturns it by launching XAI. On the other hand, he talks about the implant technologies being so slow that we won't even notice. An unnoticed change is like slowly boiling a frog to death. The warning signs are there, but there is no urgency. If it were to happen suddenly, it would trigger an emergency. The evolution of the human species is intimately tied with the adaptive advantage of tool use. We as a species must now consider, is the human brain an evolutionary dead end, or is intelligence meant to evolve beyond the biological towards hybrid cognition? Evolutionarily speaking, the development of the cerebral cortices is already overpowered, far more than necessary for survival in nature. Without nature providing a challenge for our survival, the human species has become fundamentally flawed. As a species, we are evolving far more closely with technology than with nature, and in some cases under the direct selection pressure of the very tools that we have invented. Thinking is a luxury afforded to humanity, and generative AI is already making thinking unnecessary and can potentially phase out higher order thinking as we outsource cognitively demanding concepts to AI. And this could mean the end of humanity, since what makes us human is sovereignty. The optimistic descendants of the great apes may be the last generation of truly biological Homo sapiens, and my hope for humanity is for us to form human-to-human bonds built on trust, support, safety, and above all, love, before AI reaches singularity, an event horizon that is far beyond human comprehension. I'd like to leave you with my final thoughts from my opening keynote at the International Mental Health Conference. I guess final thoughts on this is the technologies that we create is a reflection of us. So we need to step away from technology for a little bit to find that connection within ourselves before we engage, because we already know our first contact with AI happened years ago when recommendation algorithms came on board. And first, when, you know, when Facebook was there, we were sharing genuine stories. But then in order to get more engagement, we weaponized that. We started being more vulnerable and weaponized vulnerability, which vulnerability is a very sacred state. Yet in the hands of technology, the first contact with it changed our relationship to vulnerability. So in order to have a meaningful relationship with technology, we have to have a meaningful relationship with ourselves and then see where it leads us.